So yeah, hi everyone. My name is Josh. I'm the CEO and co-founder of a company called AdhereTech. We make patented smart pill bottles that track and improve medication adherence. So basically, medication adherence is a term that describes patients taking the right pill at the right time. Non-adherence is one of the biggest problems in healthcare today. $300 billion in costs, $100 billion in lost revenues for pharma, 125,000 premature deaths in the US alone every year. So that's why we created this bottle. And here's how it works. So basically, we put cell phone technology inside of the bottle. So actually, it is a wireless module, same thing you'd find in a pager or a cell phone. Goes inside of our bottle. Every time the patient uses the bottle sends us a bunch of measurements that sort of tell us when it was open and closed, tells us about the contents inside. That gets analyzed by our servers in real time. What our servers do is essentially they compare what patients are doing to what they should be doing. This all happens automatically and in real time. And based on that analysis, we either intervene with a patient or we decide not to intervene. And the way that we do intervene, it's fully customizable. We do that in a number of different ways. I will show you, this is one of the bottles that patients are actively using in trials. These bottles have been active in trials since 2013 with a bunch of different pharma companies. But we intervene through on-bottle lights and chimes. So the bottle can light up different colors, it can beep. And then we also intervene via automated phone call or text message alert. The idea being that, you know, if a patient's close to the bottle, the on-bottle alerts work. If they're far away, phone or text is the right way to intervene. And then all data populates on our dashboard in real time. So, you know, if you're a researcher or a pharma company, you can know what all the patients are doing. But what makes this solution really unique and interesting is that we're collecting data that's never been collected before. So the way we look at our company is, you know, create the most sleek, simple-to-use device. It's all about the data that collects, that the device collects and how we leverage that. So we collect patients' real-time adherence, which has never been collected, but we also collect their reasons for non-adherence. So the way we do that is through what we call our patient feedback feature. So the way that works is if you're a patient, you miss your dose, you get those on-bottle lights and chimes, you get a text message as well or a phone call, whatever you prefer. If you still haven't taken your meds after a certain period of time, we then ask you why. And we do that via phone or text. But the interesting part is that we then route that answer to a live nurse. The reason why this is so important is because we work with, like, cancer and HIV patients. Oftentimes, their reasons for non-adherence are really complicated issues like, these meds make me feel really sick, or the dosing schedule is really complicated. So with this solution, we can now know that on day one or two, as opposed to the status quo when you really have no insight into a patient missing a dose of medication until they're late for their refill. So, you know, we're really trying to become more than just a piece of hardware that reminds patients into, like, a larger care platform. Additionally, so the value of the data goes beyond, like, this real-time intervention. Patients have also never been asked in real time why they don't take their meds. So I'll give you guys an example of why this is so valuable. So if I asked you what you had for dinner last Wednesday, chances are you couldn't tell me. Even if you could, you probably couldn't tell me, like, the specific details, what you liked about your meal, what you didn't. Well, this is how non-adherence data is collected today, right? You're a patient, you go into your doctor's office, the doctor's like, "Well, why didn't you take your meds?" Not only are you answering for something that happened weeks ago, but you're also giving one answer for many unique instances of non-adherence. So the cool thing about this technology is we can now ask in real time, find out the real reasons, like, you know, the psyche of the patient at that time, and then build novel interventions as we really begin to gather a lot of data. Two main business models. I'll breeze through, like, the, you know, product pitchiness aspect, because I know I should be trying to avoid that. But two main business models. Number one, we work with pharma companies to put existing drugs in our bottles, so drugs that are on the market, but high-cost medications for, like, cancer and HIV. These pills are often, like, hundreds of dollars per single pill. They go in our bottle. Patients are more adherent to their medication. Average adherence rates are about, like, 60% to 70%. So we lift that. Patients are healthier. It's free for patients. Pharma pays us. because pharmacies increase revenues because patients are taking closer to the optimal level of medication. And then the other model that we operate in is what we call our clinical trial model. So clinical trials, bringing new drugs to market, pharma companies spend billions upon billions of dollars to do this, but the way they do it is really antiquated. Like, there's no, they don't interact with patients every day. So if there's a drug that's making people sick, the pharma company really has no insight in real time. So with our solution, we can provide that insight. Basically, long story short, it helps bring new drugs to market quicker. So, high-level traction about where we are today. These bottles have been used in trials since 2013. We're working with a bunch of top pharma companies as well, a bunch of top research institutions. Wherever we can add value with our solution, we're open to exploring those opportunities. And distributed through a number of different means. So the solution is also incredibly flexible. Basically, the cool thing about adherence is when you improve adherence, every party in healthcare benefits, either through increased revenues or reduced costs because patients are now healthier. So there's lots of places where the key fits with this solution. So what makes us unique is if you examine the landscape of all these other medication adherence tools, they all have this inherent disconnect in that they're asking patients who don't take their meds to go through these long and complicated processes to set up and use tools to help them take their meds. So I'll give you some examples. You have medication adherence apps. Not only are you requiring a patient to have a smartphone, but now you're saying download this app, engage with the app every day. The patients that really need the help aren't the type to do that. Patients that use those tools are already highly motivated, typically don't really have non-adherence is a big issue in their life. So just a disconnect there. Also, you have those like big Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday pill boxes that you may have seen like your grandparents use. That's also, you're asking a patient to not only set it up, but set it up correctly. These are really big hurdles a lot of patients won't go through. Lots of other gizmos that you like can sync to Bluetooth or Wi-Fi. The problem is, a lot of people don't have access to those technologies, and the patient that will even go through steps to sync to Wi-Fi, sync to Bluetooth, they don't need the help. So when we designed the solution, we said we need something that patients literally don't have to set up at all, and it doesn't require them to do anything new in order to use it. So no new workflows for the patient. So that's really where the cellular technology comes in. That's why we decided to go that route. Yes, it makes the product COGS a little more expensive, but it also means when the patient gets their meds in that bottle, it's just working. They don't have to do anything different. It's completely passive. There's no new workflows required. We just monitor this all automatically. We only intervene if necessary. And then the battery also lasts 100 days. So the way we do that is the battery in the in the bottle is the same battery that's in a cell phone. Basically, all the components in our bottle mimic a cell phone pretty closely. But obviously cell phones always have to be on because they have to not only send but receive data at any time whenever it's trying to be reached by any party. Our bottles go into a sleep mode all the time except for two instances. Not when the bottle's open and closed. It'll send a little blip out and also see if there's any data that it needs to read. Also, it has what we call a heartbeat. So every X hours, it just turns on for a sec, turns off. So power requirements, really well managed. But again, the reason why we did this is so you're not requiring a patient to charge it every day because patients don't charge pill bottles every day. We don't want to require them to do any new stuff. So that was the thought process behind that. Fully customizable. Everything about our solution, two main philosophies make it easy to use, make it fully customizable. So if you're a high-tech patient, we can intervene via text. Low-tech, we do automated phone calls for proverbial grandparents, so anyone could use it no matter what level of technical expertise, even though it's a high-tech product. We have a really neat technology inside of the bottle that's an automatic refill sensor. So the way that works is it's a capacitive sensor that we line the bottom of the interior of the bottle with. So same technology that determines if you touch the screen of your smartphone, we put in the bottom of the bottle. What that does, it's able to tell us when the amount of medication in the bottle is trending downward. so we can trigger a refill before patients need it. The reason why this is so important is because one of the leading reasons for non-adherence is patients, emptying, taking all their meds, then going to the pharmacy, waiting 2 or 3 days before they pick it up. So because we can issue that refill before they need it, we overcome that hurdle. And then in regard to privacy, safety, security, we're an FDA-registered Class 1 medical device, HIPAA-compliant. Basically, there's tons of different regulations, but we abide by them all. But one of the concluding remarks I have is that it's actually not as scary as one might think. So, one of the biggest things we have on the horizon is our Generation 2 smart pill bottle. So, like I said, these bottles have been active in trials since 2013. They work really, really well. This is our Gen 1 bottle. One of the biggest pieces of feedback we got is that patients want something that's more inconspicuous. If you have a very serious disease, you don't want something necessarily that looks really cool and have people asking you what it is. So the Gen 2 bottle, this is a 3D printed prototype, will look and feel more like a normal bottle. It has the same volume as an orange bottle of this size, so you can see it's pretty similar. Obviously, the extra space goes toward all the electronic components. But the whole idea is make it as similar to a normal pill bottle as possible. That one's coming out in March, April 2015, but it's tons of improvements, better battery life, fully scalable, really easy to produce. So we're really excited about that. Three things that sort of make us unique: we're the easiest adherence solution, very customizable, and then we leverage all this data in real time. But that's kind of product pitchy, so let me focus on three lessons that we sort of learned, and then I'll open it up to Q&A. So I guess the biggest distinction that we have as our device relates to our business model, we really see there's two types of connected devices out there. There's devices patients or people will pay for, and then there's devices that people will not pay for, sort of given to them for free for another reason. So, all connected devices, or 99% that people currently use, they buy, right? Like cell phones, fitness trackers, TVs, et cetera. Those devices have this luxury in that patients or users are willing to go through setup hurdles because they put their hard-earned money out there, they sought it out, they go to a store to buy it, they're like, okay, I'll spend 5 minutes to set this up. But a lot of devices, specifically in healthcare, are given to patients for free because some other company saves a lot of money if this patient uses this device and becomes a lot healthier, like an insurance company or a pharma company. So they give it to the patient for free, but the patient has never gone through the thought process of, oh, I really want this device, I'm gonna go out and buy it. So the device, like our device, we don't have this luxury of saying, oh, the patient's gonna go through this long, complicated setup process. So because we fall into the latter category, a device that's given to patients for free, we have to make this incredibly easy to use and set up. So a lot of the points I was talking about, no setup, no new workflows, are for that reason, for this unique philosophy. A lot of other devices we see out there in healthcare fall into the latter category, but aren't designed with those thought processes in mind. Number two, so not only do we have to fit into our existing patient workflows, but also our customer workflows. So, we've literally gone onto the floors of mail order pharmacies, seen exactly how they're filled. We designed the product accordingly. It was a bit of a headache, but something I can't stress enough in terms of being incredibly valuable and making our product work really well. And then number three, when we started this, we were really scared of the regulations that are out there. FDA approval, basically making sure your device passes certain levels of safety, we were extremely scared of. Once we really dove in and we worked with people that sort of knew how to navigate the process, I don't want to say it was easy, but it was no more difficult than any other hurdle that you have as a company. HIPAA compliance, making sure the data is protected, that's a very similar process, but again, there are services out there. And they're also not incredibly expensive. They are in the tens of thousands of dollars, but they will help you go through this. So, high-level conclusion about point number three is don't let the fear of regulations prevent you from starting something that you think can help people, because they are able to be overcome in a way that's a lot easier than you might think. So Yeah, with that, I'll open up the floor to Q&A, but really appreciate all your time. Josh with AdhereTech. Thank you.
Thanks, Josh. I'll take the first one.
Sure.
We had Ted from Toro Labs, I guess, a couple of sessions ago.
Yeah.
Just curious, so they were involved in the early stages of helping out with this, right? Any sort of thoughts, not on Toro Labs specifically, although you know, I feel like I'm...
Absolutely.
But any thoughts on the advantages and drawbacks of working with an outside shop to get things started initially?
Yeah, totally. So the Gen 1 bottle, we built my team, which at the time was just me. I do the business role and two engineers. One does a lot of the mechanical engineering work. Another guy does a lot of the coding. So pretty well-balanced team for hardware, but we were pretty small at the time. We worked with this company called Tomorrow Lab. They're like a really early stage IDEO product design house in New York that are awesome. So first of all, if you want to start something, I can't recommend anyone. I can't recommend them highly enough. They're awesome, Tomorrow Lab. But it is really valuable, in my opinion, to work with outside shops when you're developing new products, simply because, and there will be, I'm sure, 100 exception cases to this idea. When we built the Gen 1 bottle, and we're going through a similar process with the Gen 2 bottle, we have, a year of development where we really need a huge product design team and product development team that will help us build this bottle. But once the bottle's built, I don't want to say we won't need them, but we won't need them like day to day. So in our opinion, it was right to work with an outside firm as opposed to hire a lot of that in-house. That said, a lot, like my team does have experience in the manufacturing space, so they were able to manage that. But outside firms are great because the amount of money we spent to work with them, and the Gen 2 is being built by this company called Intelligent Product Solutions. They're a spin-off of Motorola, more or less. But they're also awesome. But you have these professionals with 20 plus years each experience, and compared to hiring them, it's a lot cheaper, and it's a great way to go. Yeah, so basically any med can go in the bottle. It's really similar to any med can go into the traditional orange bottle. The two measurements that we take aren't really that affected by pill size. So, number one is the open and close of the cap. So, right, pill size, shape, et cetera, doesn't really affect that. Number two, the sensor on the bottom of the bottle that determines when the amount of medication is trending down. We know which patient's using which bottle, and we do have ways of at least knowing which medication is in which bottle, and we're able to manage this in a way that doesn't violate HIPAA in any way. We have anonymous codes for all this stuff, but we know the med, so we know like if it gets this much touch then on this med, then it has this many pills, basically just correlating it analogous to how weight might be correlated if it was a weight sensor. The question was, can we work with liquids? Our patent cover, well, we have two patents, and they cover liquids, but no, this device is solids only, but in the pipeline, liquids.
Yeah. So some of the managed hospice care, there are a couple of questions I had. One is, the diseases you identify, typically those patients are motivated, right? They're not missing. Second question I have, it's not just one pill, it's usually a variety. 15 or 16 pain medication, Colase, you name it, right?
Yeah.
So are you thinking about that? And thirdly, every time you do a hospital visit, or because the medication will stop working, you've got to reset that process. And how do you, have you thought about those areas?
Yeah, so first question, yeah, you're absolutely right. Adherence rates tend to be higher. In the disease stage in which we work. That said, they're very far from perfect. Like, they'll be in the 80s as opposed to the 60s 90% adherence. So it's still a huge problem, but that's why we're also going beyond a tool that reminds. You know, this is a tool that if you don't take your pills, we ask you why. We know, you know, that you have side effects. We route that to a live nurse. So it's all about leveraging the data in the smartest way possible. But you're right. It's the patients that have the hugest problems have that issue with blood pressure. Number two, the multiple med question. So this isn't, a lot of people will like look at the solution and say, you know, there's every patient out there, like it wouldn't be perfect for them. We agree, this isn't necessarily for every patient, but the drugs in which this excels, there's a huge movement of consolidating drug therapies that used to be in multiple meds into single pills. So that's really where a lot of our partnerships are, and that's where we excel. We've definitely thought about that, but then we run into the issue of now you're asking the patient to do a lot of stuff to use it, and will patients actually use it? It's definitely something we've thought about, but at least at this stage, we're focused on the single pill. Simply because, you know, patients get their meds in that bottle. Vast majority of patients keep their meds in the bottle in which it comes in. But it does resonate with a lot of our customers. So.
Just one last one. You're going to be around for this, right? Oh, no, that's right.
Yeah.
Okay, let's take this last question, and then this will make sense in a minute.
Yeah, so as a medical devices startup, do you have any sort of difficulties getting this manufactured? Is this some sort of regulation that you go through different from like a regular startup? And also, can you describe if there's certain like steps that you need to do to get this approved as such?
There are additional steps you have to go through. I mean, whether it's using plastic of a certain grade that we have to do, or going through certain tests to make sure. Not only are you FDA approved, not only are you HIPAA compliant, but there's lots of regulations about how a cap can close and how much moisture can get let in. I know a lot about medication packaging. I don't know so much about other devices. What I can say is yes, it's different than other hardware startups. And as a general rule, something we've learned is that as long as it's not a tool, and this might also be incorrect, but the real difficult approval processes are with tools that either go inside of the body or are used to diagnose, so to say what the issue is. There's tons of nuance to that as well, but yeah, there's additional stuff you have to do in healthcare, and it's not easy, but it's not that scary.
Great. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
So that was about to refer to saving in terms of the workflow. Is that Chief Gersh's birthday today?
Yep.
He's actually about to go out to Dr. Dana Priest's birthday. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you. This is awesome.